So what is a circuit breaker? A circuit breaker is a mechanical switching device which is capable of making, carrying and breaking currents under normal circuit conditions. It is also capable of making and breaking currents during abnormal conditions such as short circuits. Very good definition. So basically it is a mechanical switch which can make the circuit, break the circuit and hold the circuit during normal operations. Just like your fan switch. So what's fan switch? When you close the switch, before closing the switch, the current through the circuit is how much? Zero. Suppose your fan is taking full load current of say 2 ampere. It is taking a current of 2 ampere. So once you switch on, that switching process, that making of circuit process, it is making a current of 2 amperes. 2 amperes. Initially it is making not 2, but 2 amperes plus DC offset current. 2 amperes plus DC offset current. So the process of circuit is called making of the circuit. So suddenly when you turn off the fan, what is the current flowing before switching off? 2 ampere. And suddenly you are making that 2 ampere current to zero. That means you are breaking 2 ampere current. You are breaking 2 ampere current. So once you switch on, till you switch off, the switch is carrying how much current? 2 ampere current. Understand? So for a 2 ampere fan, what is the making current? Making current is 2 ampere plus some DC offset component, some transient component. So this is the current which you are making once you close the switch. What is the carrying current or carrying current or holding current under normal conditions? So once the DC offset component dies out, the current flowing through the switch is 2 ampere. What is breaking current? The breaking current for the fan is 2 ampere. You are cutting the 2 ampere current to zero. So a circuit breaker can make the normal current, carry the normal current and break the normal current. So during short circuit, the currents flowing through the line are very high. So in that condition, it will not do this function. It will not carry. It is not capable of carrying or holding the short circuit currents. It can only make the short circuit currents or break the short circuit currents. Okay. So it is also capable of making and breaking currents during abnormal conditions like short circuit. Okay. That is the concept. What are the types of circuit breakers we are having? We are having many types of circuit breakers, out of which there are MCBs, miniature circuit breaker, MCCB, molded case circuit breaker, ACB, air circuit breakers, VCB, vacuum circuit breakers, SF6 circuit breakers, sulfur hexafluoride circuit breakers, oil circuit breakers, and air blast circuit breakers. Understand? So these are the different types of circuit breakers which are used in the industry. Okay. Now, before going into all these concepts, first you should know what is the major function of circuit breaker. If I write few devices which you know, there are two operations. One is called switching. I'll just tell you a few operations. What is switching? What is isolation? Overload protection. The other one is short circuit protection. Short circuit protection. Okay. So basically once you take this first device, that is a switch, normal switch which we use. So switch is what? Switching is, what is switching? Making, breaking and carrying normal currents is called switching. So making normal currents or full load currents, breaking full load currents and carrying full load currents. So all these three operations include switching. So a switch will do switching. Switch will do switching. What is isolation? Isolation is making or breaking under no load conditions. Under no load conditions. That means what? You are making the circuit when it is carrying zero currents. You are breaking the circuit when it is carrying zero currents. That is called isolation. That is called isolation. Okay. So switch can also do isolation. When it can make or break full load currents, it can definitely make or break zero currents. Okay. But switch does not offer any overload protection. Switch will not provide any overload or any short circuit protection. Understand? Switch can only do switching as well as isolation. The second element is isolator. Isolator should not be used for switching. Isolator should not be used for switching. What happened? The arcs are formed and the lifetime will gradually reduce. Lifetime will gradually reduce. So isolator should be only used for isolation. It cannot provide overload protection and short circuit protection. Okay. Now, sir, where isolators are used? When it is not carrying, when you are making or breaking. See, isolator can make and break zero currents, but can carry full load currents. Isolator makes and breaks no load current, which means it is no load current is nothing but zero current, comma, it can carry full load current. Only it can carry. Whereas switch can make, break and carry full load currents. Understand? So basically, suppose if you take a transformer, on either end you have a circuit breaker. Okay. So after that circuit breaker, there is one more equipment called isolator. There is one more equipment called isolator. Okay. So what is the major function of this isolator? This isolator provides backup security. Suppose this is source side. This is load side. So basically when you want to take into maintenance, what you will do? First you will put off load. You will open the circuit breaker on load side. Let us call this circuit breaker 2. So first operation what you do is open circuit breaker 2. That means you are disconnecting the load. Okay. So after opening circuit breaker, what you have to do to prevent any maloperation, if some command comes and closes circuit breaker 2, people are working, there is a chance of getting short circuit. So what you shall do, you shall also open isolator. That means you are breaking the switch at not one location but two locations with the help of isolators. If suppose some nuisance happens in circuit breaker, at least this isolator will protect you. Okay. So similarly here also, you open circuit breaker 1 to disconnect the source, and then also after disconnecting circuit breaker 1, after opening circuit breaker 1, what is the current through the primary? The current through the primary is 0. When it is carrying 0 ampere, you also open isolator. So isolator provides backup opening. That means double the number of openings in the circuit should be more than one. You should never trust single opening. Okay, you don't know what will happen. So you should at least minimum isolate the circuit at two locations. So for backup isolation, for backup breaking of circuits, we use the isolators. Understand? Third element is fuse. third element is fuse. So fuse cannot do switching, but it can do isolation. It can do isolation. It can do overload protection as well as it can do short circuit protection. That means if you remove fuse, that is isolation, but you cannot toggle like a switch, so it will not do switching. It can do isolation, overload, and short circuit protection. MCB, miniature circuit breaker, or Molder gauge circuit breaker, or any other circuit breaker for that matter, it will do switching, it will do isolation, it will do overload protection, and it will do short circuit protection. Understand? So MCB can be used, MCB or MCCB can be used for all the four activities. What is the advantage of MCB or MCCB over fuse is that if fuse blows, you have to have the spare to replace it immediately. If you don't have the spare, you have to purchase and replace it. So the fault clearing time is more in case of fuse. And in case of MCB, once MCB trips, you can immediately by turning it on, you are switching on the circuit. So MCB is very fastly replacing the fuse in most of the electrical, low voltage electrical circuits. So these are the four devices, and we have to understand what is isolation, what is switching, what is overload protection, and what is how the arc is initiated in the circuit breaker. So every circuit breaker has two types of contacts. One is fixed contact and other is the moving contact. Understand? So every circuit breaker has two types of contacts. The first one is called fixed contacts and the second one is moving contacts. So generally most of the breakers are three pole circuit breakers, that is one pole for each phase. Understand? So normally when circuit breaker is closed, what will be the position? Suppose this is the contacts which we are using. Just for your understanding, I am using this type of contact. So this is how the current will flow. So this one is fixed contact, and this one is the moving contact. So when the things are normal, both the contacts are closed and the current flowing is the, let us say if it is operating at full load, it is the full load current is carried by the both fixed and moving contact. So there will be three such contacts, one for R phase, one for Y phase, and one for B phase. Understand? So all these three contacts included, it will form the circuit breaker. Understand? So now, when the fault occurs, let us assume the fault is occurring at, let us assume some fault occurred at t is equals to 0. Let the time instant at which the fault occurred is say t equal to 0. So what happens before t equal to 0 minus, that is before t equal to 0, what is the condition? This is the condition. Both fixed and moving contacts are closed. They are carrying full load current. So when the fault occurs at t equal to 0 plus, that is immediately after occurrence of fault, what is the condition? Yes, the circuit breaker contacts are closed. They are in the closed condition only. But now what is the current flowing through them? The current flowing through them is not full load current, but they are carrying fault current. They are carrying now fault current. Why? Because the fault has already occurred. Understand? Now, at t equal to, so now what happens? Relay will take some time to sense the fault. Let us assume relay has taken ms to give trip command to circuit breaker. I hope you are understanding. The fault occurred at t equal to 0. So before t equal to 0, my circuit breaker is carrying, the fixed and moving contacts are carrying full load current. Immediately after occurrence of fault, that is at t equal to 0 plus, the circuit breaker is carrying, it is in still closed condition, but it is carrying the fault current. Okay. Immediately after occurrence of faults, the relay will take some time to sense the fault. That time is called relay time. What is relay time? The time interval between the instant of occurrence of fault to the time instant where the trip coil of circuit breaker is energized. That is called relay time. Usually it is from 20 to 40 milliseconds. 20 to 40 milliseconds is the relay time. Relay time. Okay. So relay time is the time instant, time interval between the instant of occurrence of fault to the instant where the circuit breaker trip coil is energized. Okay. So after tilling, so immediately at t equal to relay time plus, after relay time, what will happen? Because now the trip command that is the trip circuit is energized, the moving and fixed contact start separating. That means the fixed contact will remain like this only, but the moving contact starts separating. This is a fixed contact. The moving contacts just start separating. Okay. So this I am writing it as a moving contact in red. It just starts separating. Okay. So once they start separating, what happens? Before, when they are in closed condition, what is the voltage across the moving and fixed contact? Voltage across the circuit breaker is 0. Voltage between the fixed and moving contact is 0. Understand? Let us call this voltage V. Voltage across them is 0 because both are in closed condition. Now, once they start separating, there is some net positive voltage that is developed between them. Let us call this voltage is called, let this voltage is called V, voltage across circuit breaker contacts. Let us call this as VCB. So, there is a small voltage that is developed, let us call that delta V. And previously they are in closed condition. Let the small distance between them, this let us call delta X. Okay. So, voltage gradient, that means once the fixed and moving contact starts separating, then some voltage gradient is developed between the fixed and moving contact. Fixed and moving contact. That voltage gradient is given by voltage across the circuit breaker poles. The voltage between the fixed and moving contact divided by the distance between them. Distance between them. Distance of separation between them. So just the moment when the moving contact starts separating with the fixed contact, this voltage gradient value will be very, very high. It will be very, very high. So usually this voltage gradient will be say 100 to 200 kV per centimeter. Very high voltage gradient is developed. One at the moment when the just moving contact starts separating this one. So this high voltage gradient will break the dielectric strength of the medium, breaks the dielectric strength of the medium between the fixed and moving contact. It can be air. If the fixed and moving contacts are kept in air, it can be air. It can be oil. If the fixed and moving contacts are kept in oil, it can be SF6 or it can be any other medium where the fixed and moving contact are kept. So the high voltage gradient, what is the other name for voltage gradient? Electric field intensity. High voltage gradient. Or electric field intensity between fixed and moving contact, the high voltage gradient between fixed and moving contact when moving contacts just separates from voltage gradient or the electric field intensity that is developed between the fixed and moving contact. When moving contact just separates from fixed contact, will break the dielectric strength of medium. In which circuit breaker contacts are present. Okay. So once the dielectric strength of the medium is broken, once the medium starts conducting, an arc is formed between the fixed and moving contact. Okay. So this arc is a very good conducting. It has a very low resistance. So the fault current which was flowing through the fixed and moving contacts, now it starts flowing through the arc. So this fault current continues to flow. So it will flow in the form of current in the contacts and in the gap between the fixed and moving contact, it flows through the arc. So what is the main reason for the arc initiation? It is the voltage gradient, high voltage gradient that is developed when the circuit breaker contacts just starts separating. So this high voltage gradient will break the dielectric strength of medium, because of which the arc is initiated. Due to high voltage gradient, the dielectric strength of the medium in which the contacts are placed breaks down and the medium starts conducting. That is, the arc is initiated. Okay. So what this is called field emission. Because of high electric field intensity, what happens? The dielectric strength of the medium breaks. This is called field emission. Okay. So once the arc is initiated, what will happen? This arc has very high, this arc generates huge amount of heat. Understand? So this heat generated by arc is given by fault current flowing through the arc into arc resistance into time in which the arc flows. So this is a huge, because fault current itself is 10 times full load current. The square of fault current and arc resistance is very small. So because of this huge amount of heat, even though the fixed and moving contacts get separated, because within very few milliseconds, the fixed and moving contacts gets separated, they go to their original position before closing. Okay. So this is the fixed contact. This is the moving contact. Now they are completely separated. Okay. But however, due to this huge amount of heat generated, the fault current continue to flow through the arc. The fault current continue to flow through the arc. Understand? This is the arc. Okay. So the voltage between the fixed and moving contact when the arc is present, this is called V arc. The current flowing through the arc, which is same as the fault current. So heat generated by the arc is IF square into R arc. So this arc is purely resistive and it has very low resistance. So the heat generated by arc is IF square into R arc into the time for which the arc sustains. So even though the fixed and moving contact are separated, the arc is sustained by the huge amount of heat generated by the arc. Okay. Arc is sustained by enormous heat energy generated by arc. Okay. So this is called thermal emission. Thermal emission. Why? Because for conducting, what we require to carry the current, we require free electrons. In the first case, the free electrons are provided by the dielectric medium because its dielectric strength is broken. In the second case, the number of, again, this dielectric strength is broken by the huge amount of heat generated by the arc. So the arc is initiated by thermal emission. The arc is initiated by the field emission. The arc is sustained by the thermal emission. That is the main important part. Okay. Now, what is the properties of arc? Arc is purely resistive. Its resistance is less. The power factor of arc is unity. Arc has negative temperature coefficient. That means if you reduce the temperature, what will happen? Sorry, if you increase the temperature, what will happen? The resistance of arc will decrease. Resistance of arc will decrease. Understand? So, more is the heat. Normally, if you increase the temperature, the resistance of any object, any metallic conductor will increase. But whereas arc, it will decrease. Arc resistance has negative temperature coefficient. As you increase the temperature, the arc resistance will decrease, which is more dangerous. If the arc resistance decreases, what will happen? The arc current or the fault current will increase. That is given by V arc divided by I R arc. R arc. Understand? So to increase the resistance of arc, if you increase the arc resistance, what will happen? The current flowing through the arc will be reduced. So to increase the arc resistance, we have to cool the arc. To increase resistance of arc, we have to cool the arc. That is the point. Understand? So this arc is undesirable. Why? Because as long as the arc is there, the fault current continues to flow through the arc. So this arc should be quenched. This arc should be put off. Okay. So what are the basic philosophies involved in quenching of this arc? What are the basic philosophies that are involved in arc quenching of the arc? So to quench the arc, arc is established and current is flowing because there are free electrons present between the fixed and moving contact. Okay. So removal of charged particles, that means if you remove the free electrons present between the fixed and moving contact, if you remove the free electrons that are present between the fixed and moving contact, what will happen? Then the arc can be quenched. The other mechanism is we can cool the medium. If you cool the medium that is present between fixed and moving contact, again the arc resistance will increase. If arc resistance will increase, the arc current will decrease. Once the arc current decreases to a sufficiently low value, then arc is put off. So the two methods of arc quenching is removing charged particles or free electrons between fixed and moving contacts of circuit breaker. And the second point is by cooling the medium between the fixed and moving contact, we are increasing arc resistance and decreasing arc current. If arc current is reduced, if arc current is reduced to a sufficiently low value, then arc is put off. So these are the two philosophies that we use for quenching the arc, removing the charged particles between the fixed and moving contacts, or cooling the medium between the fixed and the moving contacts. Understand? Now, what are the methods which we adopt, the philosophies we have discussed, the methods of arc interruption? The first method is called high resistance method. So in this method, what we are doing, we are increasing the resistance of arc. Here we are increasing arc resistance so that arc current is reduced. And if arc current is reduced to a sufficiently low value, then the arc is automatically put off. Okay. So what are the methods to increase the arc resistance? This arc resistance is increased by the following methods. What we do is we split the arc, okay, lengthen the arc, increase the path, lengthening of arc, okay. The second one is forced air blast. Okay. Second, the other methods are cooling of arc. Okay. So all these methods where we are increasing the resistance of arc, that is either by using arc splitters. This is done by using arc splitters. Usually this technique is adopted in air circuit breakers. That means air circuit breakers. Okay. Lengthening of arc also, we use arc chutes to increase the length of arc. In air blast circuit breakers and SF6 circuit breakers, what we do? We give a high pressurized air or pressurized sulfur hexafluoride. Understand? Cooling of arc is basically done in oil circuit breakers. So all these methods where you increase the resistance of arc, okay, these are all the techniques which we use to in high resistance method. So high resistance method is used for can be used for both AC and DC circuit breakers. Okay. Basically, mainly used for breaking low fault currents. Understand? It can be used for both AC as well as DC circuit breakers, high resistance. Understand? The second method is called low resistance method or natural current zero method. Understand? So here this method is based on that whatever may be the fault current, it can be any fault current. Suppose this is the waveform of fault current. For every cycle, the fault current automatically becomes zero in AC circuits. The fault current becomes zero twice in every one cycle. So whenever the fault current becomes zero, for that short momentary period, the arc between fixed and moving contacts also becomes zero. Suddenly the arc that is between fixed and moving contact, suddenly it gets quenched at current zero. So during this instant where the current becomes zero, where the arc is automatically becoming zero, then what will happen? To again reignite the arc, there is some voltage called a restriking voltage. Okay. So when arc current becomes zero, the voltage across circuit breaker poles will become very high. So this, the high voltage that appears across circuit breaker poles when the arc becomes zero is called a restriking voltage. This is very high value. So now when the current becomes zero, one voltage is called restriking voltage that is appearing across the, this is called restriking voltage, is called VR, that is appearing across the fixed and moving contact. When the current becomes zero, there is some other thing that is also trying to get into picture. The dielectric strength of the medium is also trying to retain its position. So during this natural current zero, there is a competition between the dielectric strength of the medium and the restriking voltage. Understand? If the rate of rise of restriking voltage and rate of rise of dielectric strength, both will compete each other. Okay. The first one is that if the rate of rise of restriking voltage is dominant than the rate of rise of dielectric strength of medium, then the arc will restrike. Understand? So what we have discussed, when the arc current becomes zero, the voltage across circuit breakers will become very high. This voltage is called restriking voltage. Okay. At current zero point, the arc momentarily extinguishes at this point if rate of increase of dielectric strength of medium is greater than rate of rise of restriking voltage. That means if the rate at which the dielectric medium is developing, if it is greater than the rate of rise of restriking voltage, the arc will not restrike. Restrike means will not reappear. The arc will not restrike. If other thing happens, that means if the rate of increase of dielectric strength is less than the rate of increase of restriking voltage, then arc will restrike. So one is rate of rise of restriking voltage, if is greater than rate of rise of dielectric strength, arc restrikes. Whereas if rate of rise of restriking voltage is less than rate of rise of dielectric strength, arc is extinguished. That means it will not come back. Arc will not come back. Okay. So this concept is called voltage recovery theory. Voltage recovery theory. Understand? So at current zero, there is a competition between the dielectric strength and restriking voltage. Whoever wins, the consequence will be like this. Understand? The other theory that explains the restriking of arc is called energy balance theory. Energy balance theory. Energy balance theory. Understand? So, according to energy balance theory, the concept of arc restriking is explained in this manner. What he says that the rate of heat dissipation is greater than, if the rate at which the heat is dissipated is greater than rate of heat generation by arc, the rate of heat dissipation by some cooling method, if it is greater than the rate of heat generation by the arc, then arc will not restrike. Arc will not come back. Okay. If the reverse happens, that means if the rate of heat dissipation is less than the rate of heat generation by the arc will again restrike and it will sustain. It will sustain. So this is the first one is called voltage recovery rate theory. The second one is energy balance theory. So these two theories will explain when the arc will come back and when the arc will not come back. The arc is not restriking means the arc is completely quenched. Arc is completely quenched. If arc does not restrike, it means arc is completely quenched. Understand? So this is the two philosophies that will explain the arc reignition of arc and arc quench. Understand? So how the arc energy will be, suppose when the circuit breaker is completely closed, what is the voltage of across the arc? The voltage across the circuit breaker poles is zero. So voltage across the circuit breaker poles is zero. That means the heat energy is how much? Zero. Okay. Once the arc is finally quenched, this is the situation. There is no arc between fixed and moving contacts. Understand? So before arc, the voltage across the circuit breaker poles is zero because both are in closed condition. Heat energy generated by arc is how much? Heat energy by arc is V arc square divided by R arc into T. Since before arc, V arc is equals to zero, which implies heat energy generated by arc is also zero. After arc quenching means the circuit breaker poles are separated. Now the arc does not exist. Here also V arc is equals to zero. So heat energy generated by the arc is zero. So the heat energy curve will be something like this. Okay, this is the time of occurrence of fault, or you can say the time at which this is t equal to relay time plus this is equals to t equal to circuit breaker time plus. Understand? So the interval between the time interval between the instant where the circuit breaker is energized, the time interval between the instant where the circuit breaker is energized to the instant where the arc is finally quenched, this is called circuit breaker time. Circuit breaker time. Understand? So it is the time interval between the instant when the circuit breaker trip circuit is energized and the instant where the final arc is quenched. This time interval is called circuit breaker time. Understand? So fault clearing time is the sum of relay time plus circuit breaker time. Fault clearing time is the sum of relay time plus circuit breaker time. Understand? So remaining concepts we'll discuss tomorrow regarding this one. Now what we will see, we'll see the types of circuit breaker. So the first class of circuit breakers is the miniature circuit breaker or MCB, which you have seen in your household or domestic applications. So basically MCBs will come from maximum, you can have 1 ampere MCB to 1 ampere to maximum in market you can find 63 ampere. General class will be from 1 ampere to 6 ampere. They can be single pole circuit breaker, double pole circuit breaker, or this is a 4 pole circuit breaker. Even you will have 3 pole circuit breaker. So this is for single phase, this is for phase and neutral. This you can use it for 3 phase and neutral. Understand? So what is a miniature circuit breaker properties? A miniature circuit breaker automatically switches off the electrical circuit during an abnormal condition like overload and a short circuit. So it does not require any relay. Automatically it will sense overload and a short circuit. It will immediately trip it. Understand? So you remember this. Here there is C32 is there. Here C20 is there. Okay. So this values we'll discuss. What is the significance of these values? We'll see. Again, if you carefully observe, there is a very small current which shows here 10,000 ampere. 10,000 ampere. And it is C20 here. Okay. And again, you have 240 volt, 415 volt or 50 hertz. These are the nameplate details of this single pole circuit. C20, 10,000 ampere, 240 volt / 415 volt, 50 hertz, and there is tilting symbol that implies it is a AC circuit breaker. Okay, so miniature circuit breaker will trip when there is overload and short circuit. MCB is more sensitive than overcurrent fuse. It is more sensitive, more accurate than a overcurrent fuse. Handling MCB is electrically safer. Why? Because once it trips, switching on and switching off MCB is very safe and very easy. Suppose if there fault is there, it will trip immediately. You can restore the supply by turning it on. Whereas in case of fuse, what will happen? You should have a spare fuse, or you have to remove the fuse and again put the new fuse, and again you have to put it in the circuit. So it will take more time than MCB. MCB, you can immediately turn it on. Understand? So this is about MCB. The construction of MCB is something like this. So here you can observe that in MCB, this is where you connect one conductor. I'll write in black so that you can look this. So one wire is connected at this point. The other wire is connected at this point. So this is the other point. This is the point where you connect other wire. So the circuit is like this. Okay. Understand? So here, this is a bimetallic strip. This is a bimetallic strip which will sense the overload. Bimetallic strip will sense the overload and it will pull this plunger. This is a plunger you can see here. This plunger, it will pull and it will turn off. This is the trip coil. For short circuit, this trip coil will operate. For short circuit, trip coil will pull the plunger. For overload, bimetallic strip will pull the plunger, same plunger. So which will switch off the circuit breaker. Understand? So during short circuit, to split the arc, we have arc splitter. You can see arc splitter will be something. So when the arc is formed due to heavy current, this arc splitter will break that arc and it will increase the resistance of the arc. Arc splitter is also shown. Okay. So if the circuit is overloaded for a long time, the bimetallic strip becomes overheated and it will deform. This deformation of bimetallic strip causes displacement of latch point and it will trip the breaker. The current coil or trip coil is placed so that during short circuit, the magnetomotive force MMF of the coil causes plunger to hit the same latch point and make the latch displaced. So some mechanical latch is there. If you pull that mechanical latch either by bimetallic strip or by the magnetomotive force of the trip coil, the circuit breaker is tripped. Understand? The second type of circuit breakers are molded case circuit breakers. Again, most of the molded case circuit breakers are also used for low voltage applications. That is 415 volts, or you can have it for 630 volts. That means all the MCBs are used mainly for voltages below 1000 volts. The operating voltage is below 1000 volts. You will get MCCBs from 63 ampere range to, nowadays you can even get up to 6000 ampere. Okay, the MCB ranges from 63 ampere to 6000 ampere. Okay, so MCCB means molded case circuit breaker. So molded case circuit breakers provides, by default it will provide protection against short circuit and overload. Okay, it will provide protection against the short circuit and overload. So it will automatically trip when there is overload or short circuit. Sometimes some MCCBs comes with earth fault protection also. So modern day MCCBs will have microprocessor based relay, which will sense overload, short circuit and earth fault. It will sense the overload, short circuit and earth fault. It will also display the currents that are flowing through the circuit breaker. Okay. So here you can observe in this figure, there is one display meter is there. Display meter. So modern day circuit breakers can even display the currents. There is a provision to increase the settings also. Understand? So basically they can be used for operating short circuit, overload, earth fault. Earth fault. Okay. So every MCCB has some accessories like shunt trip coil and under voltage coil. Okay. So MCCB comes with some accessories like shunt trip coil and under voltage coil. Suppose apart from this short circuit, earth fault and overload tripping, you also want to incorporate some other tripping. That means some fault. Suppose there is upstream fault or downstream fault. You want to trip by some other reason apart from this overload, short circuit and earth fault. There is something called a shunt trip coil. If you energize this shunt trip coil, if suddenly voltage appears across this shunt trip coil, it will trip the circuit breaker. Okay. There is one more coil called under voltage coil. If you want to provide under voltage protection, if you energize this under voltage coil, it will also trip the circuit breaker. Okay. So for any other trippings, you have shunt trip coil. For under voltage tripping, you have under voltage coil. So you can incorporate these two additional accessories in MCCB to provide extra protection. Okay. So these are the how the MCCB images look like. MCCB image look like. Okay.